This project was supported by the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency, through its regional arts funding partnership, Pennsylvania Partners in the Arts, PPA. State government funding for the arts depends upon an annual appropriation by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and support from the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency. PPA is administered in this region by Berks Arts Council.
Arts programming on BCTV is also supported by the Wachovia Foundation.
NAP Connection is a panel discussion on selected art issues with three guests and the host, James Carroll. Home viewers are invited to call and offer comments or questions during the live telecast. NAP Connection is brought to you by the New Arts Program, a nonprofit art service organization in cooperation with Berks Community Television. The New Arts Program is supported in part by the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, local government, area businesses, NAP memberships, and individual contributions.
Hi, good afternoon, and welcome to another edition of the NAP Connection for the New Arts Program. We are broadcasting from the Berks Community Television studios out of Reading, Pennsylvania, and I am your host for tonight. My name is Ron Shira, sitting in for James Carroll. Tonight we are going to be talking about a special exhibit that is taking place over at the Reading Public Museum on the work of Jun Kaneko, who is a prominent American artist born in Japan but living in Omaha, Nebraska. And he has some sizable sculptures over at the Reading Public Museum. And I have with me as my guest tonight, the curator of the Reading Public Museum, curator of the arts, is that correct? I want to make sure I have that,
yes,
that
got it.
Title correct there. This is Scott Schweigert, right. And we're pleased to have Scott with us today, and thank you very much
for
joining us.
Sure, thanks, man. It's a pleasure.
Mm-hmm. My pleasure.
Great to be with you.
Yep. So we want to discuss this monumental show that's taking place over at the museum right now, and it's taking up the whole second floor, I'd say the temporary gallery is up on the third floor.
Right.
And it's filling the entire space plus the foyer.
Exactly, yes.
So, Mr. Kaneko is a Japanese-born artist.
Right.
And he's living in Nebraska right
yes,
now.
Yes, yes.
So
he's been in Nebraska, I think, since the mid-1980s. Mm-hmm. And he occupies a former warehouse structure. He lives in part of it and has a studio in another part of it. And so it gives him the opportunity to sort of explore the arts on the scale that Kaneko does, which is large. Some pieces are larger than 13 feet. The ones at the museum, though, are mostly around 6 or 7 feet is the maximum. Mm-hmm. But in terms of volume and weight, they go way up to 1,200 or 13 pounds each. Mm-hmm. So it created some challenges in terms of installation. Mm-hmm. You can't go back and say, no, I'd rather have that over here when you're putting down a 1,300-pound sculpture. So mm-hmm. it had to be mapped out well in advance. Mm-hmm. And in terms of pieces, the show is, it's not huge. It's only 39 pieces if you add them all up. But in terms of scale and volume and the impression that they make on the viewer, I think it is it certainly is monumental on many levels.
They carry quite a bit of presence, honestly. You walk in there, and first thing you're greeted with is this huge powder blue head. And the series would just are called heads, and they're untitled, right? So he doesn't really have the direction as to any kind of content.
He doesn't give the viewer a whole lot of information, that's for sure. Almost, I think everything in the show is called untitled. The only thing that mm-hmm. it hinges on is the date of creation, and in some cases is part of a broader series. Mm-hmm. But yeah, he shies away from attaching any sort of text mm-hmm. associated with the works. And mm-hmm. He's not alone in terms of contemporary art on that front, but he's particularly
Well, I find that to be better anyway. Yeah. I mean, a lot of times, if you stay away from a narrative and content and all of that kind of stuff, it's pretty much you're more or less directing the viewer as to what they should think about a work of art.
Yeah.
And sometimes that can become problematic, especially when you're dealing with something that has open-ended ideologies and thoughts surrounding it.
Right, and you know the theme of the human head has millennia of tradition, and mm-hmm. that's something I think that maybe he certainly has tapped into, and the heads have been something he's been approaching maybe for about the last two decades or so, the last 20 years. And again, they range in height from about 6 foot high to about 13 feet high. Mm-hmm. In fact, he did an installation down Park Avenue, New York City, a couple of years ago, mm-hmm. where some of these heads featured prominently in the sort of grass section. If you're familiar with Park Avenue, mm-hmm. the grassy sections. So these pieces, when they're within the walls of a museum, mm-hmm. really make a profound impact. When they're in the environment of New York City or Philadelphia or something like that, mm-hmm. they take on a totally different effect and persona. Mm-hmm. The heads have been attached to meditative qualities, to Eastern philosophy. They're in many cases sort of expressionless, heavy lidded, eyes closed. Mm-hmm. They don't give you a whole lot in terms of a response, or they don't return your gaze. A lot of things that you might expect to see in a human form, but they certainly are impressive.
Absolutely, it's that whole closed eye sort of introspective aspect of it as well. But there's a history of that goes that goes back to the statues of the Buddhas and
of course
all that takes place in throughout the entire Orient. But that's in that facet it's very, you almost can in a way you kind of relate with it. It almost has a sort of like not an iconic but more of a talismanic approach to it, where you sort of feel the eminence of what's coming off of those sculptures.
And the way that we've got it installed, which is up on a raised platform, and then the piece itself, part of the unit, is on a steel table, which also weighs about 900 pounds. So add it together and you're over a ton in terms of weight. So that I think that separation, that level of you coming not face to face with this, but it certainly is raised up. It creates a certain amount of reverence. It's almost religious in a way.
Well, I like that, how they use the center platform as well. I mean, you have the center platform that is in the middle of the foyer there, and then you have another platform, and then you have the head.
Right.
I mean, we have that in here. But let's take a look at the artist. Show a portrait of the artist. This is Mr. Kaneko himself, and looking very serious, as a lot of these guys always do.
Well, he was born in 42, so this year will be 68. But he's got a team of assistants who help him with some of these major projects. And as we go through, we can talk a little bit about his process and his technique. And this is Kaneko, and he's been in the United States since 1963. Mm-hmm. So he's been here for a very long time. Started out as a painter, and then quickly got caught up in the new ceramic movement in California, mm-hmm. and attached himself to sort of the leading proponents of that movement in the 1960s, and has essentially been making art ever since.
So is the institute, what is it, the Quinard?
Mm-hmm.
Is that still in operation now, or is that?
I'm not sure about that.
Just out of curiosity.
Yeah, I wouldn't doubt that it is.
Because I tried to research it and it came up with Cal Arts, so I'm thinking like
right. Maybe it was absorbed. Yeah,
it was probably absorbed into California.
Into a parent institution. Yeah.
Yeah, but let's go to the next one here and. Okay, now that's the head. That's what we were talking about, which is the table itself is what, 900 to 1,000 pounds?
Yeah.
That's solid steel.
Right.
So that's a big piece of equipment there.
Yeah.
And the head, that is what, about 7 feet tall?
It's almost 7 feet tall, right? It's a little bit better than 6 feet tall, and It is an impressive piece, that's for sure. And we had to, the museum had to contract with guys who came in with a gantry and hoisted it up. And we don't have that sort of equipment. We had to check to make sure, obviously, that the floor could withstand it, and mm-hmm. That the freight elevator could take the weight of these pieces. But it worked out beautifully. Actually, it was installed in about 2 days.
Wow, that's great.
You know, this is the sort of thing that makes a curator's heart stop in anticipation of, you know, is it going to fit through? What are we going to do once it gets here? Is the ceiling going to be high enough to accommodate the gantry and all of the equipment for the riggers that need to, you know, need to take place? So this one, again, created some installation challenges, but I think the end result is just stunning.
And this also applies into my little bugaboo about supporting the arts,
right,
about folks out there in the lands out there, far and wide. We want to support the arts, because to do something like this, it takes money. It takes money to transport it. It takes money to insure it. It takes money to install it. You know, and it takes money to pay the people that have the skills to look after it and to make it available to the public and understandable to the public, like Scott. Yeah. And this is it's important that we consider supporting the arts. Okay, I'm off my soapbox. So we'll go to the next one. There's a close-up.
Yeah, that's great. It gives you a sense of the surface and sort of the shimmer of that glaze that he applies to the pieces. And again, this is one of those pieces that he may have had to construct inside the kiln because it's too large to move once it's created to get it into the kiln. And so in some cases, Kaneko does that. He actually constructs the pieces inside these huge beehive tombs, kilns rather, that he has access to. And it eliminates the possibility of having something happen to it on the way in or the way out. But he constructs these with huge slabs of clay that are, you know, several inches thick. In some cases, it takes more than a year for the piece to dry out before it can be
before
amazing. It can be fired. And in some cases, it takes more than 30 days to fire. Anyone who works in ceramics knows that sometimes the kiln is friendly, sometimes the kiln is cruel, and so you can imagine the amount of labor that goes into these works, and to have them lost in the process.
It takes one tiny little air bubble inside of that. As I've learned in my college days, that if you have a tiny little air bubble, is when it gets heated, of course that air is going to expand, and that expansion is going to crack. Yeah. The clay, and if you've worked for a long time on having something molded and put in the right, you know, and then all it needs is boom, and then it's done.
A technical standpoint, it's absolutely incredible that he's able to achieve the results that he achieves. He kind of limits his color palette to blues, golds, red, silver, black. These are the recurrent colors that we see in a lot of his work. Sometimes he steps outside of those boundaries, but geometry is important. Drips are important. You know, he taps into many of the strains of 20th century art. You know, from pop to op to abstract expressionism. I think you can see strains of all of those things running through the surfaces of his pieces. The other thing I think that's interesting about our show is that it is pan media, which means that you get to see his drawings, paintings, small sculptures, large sculptures, and his interest in surface and color come through in a variety of ways. And that, I think, makes us unique in terms of shows.
Which you've done more than a few times, I noticed, with a couple of different exhibits. I like the video aspect that you have inside of the shows, because it really does, it educates more so than just the object. Because sometimes when you see something like this, it may come off as a little cold.
Yeah.
Or it's like, you're stunned by its size and its presence and all of the above. And, well, you know, as art objects go, I mean, it definitely has their presence. But when you have a video, and you have multiple videos that are taking place inside of the gallery, I think you had two films going in there. The one you can see, like if you look over onto the side of this one that we have up on the screen right here, to the left, you're going to see a flat screen on the wall that's describing what Mr. Kaneko was doing. I should have gotten it. I didn't, but the video of that goes into his how he how he does it. So that's very educational and very necessary, I think, and it adds an extra dimension as to how these things are done, so that people that are interested in pursuing a career in ceramics or maybe who are just scholars on it would have a much better idea of how something like this transpires.
Yeah, I think this type of show especially kind of begs for that sort of presentation, because as you said, you might be impressed by the size or the scale. You may not know quite how to respond to the work, though. You might not understand what it took to construct it, or how long the process was, or what the artist was thinking of maybe when he was in the process of creation. So this video element, I think, yeah, it does add a little bit of a dimension to the audience. And you know, the mission, part of the mission of the museum is education,
exactly.
And that's an important aspect of it. And since the artist couldn't be there for 24/7 fielding questions from visitors, it was sort of the next best thing to see him in action, or to hear his voice, or to hear his commentary or his philosophy about art. And the other video, which is in the other wing of the show, is specifically on a project that he did for a commission, an installation commission, and that is one where he did very large-scale closed forms, and so it took it from the beginning to the end of that process. So from the first construction through the drying and kiln process, the glazing, and then till they got loaded on the truck to be taken away for the installation. So just a little bit of a snapshot of what it takes to do a large scale installation like this. And Kaneko is known for this sort of thing, these outdoor sculptural installations. It's one of the things that has sort of helped to make his reputation, along with the dango, or the closed non-functional form that his ceramic sculpture take.
Okay. Now the piece that we had just seen was a dango, and that's somewhat like a vase. Essentially, it's like a vase that it's freestanding, and it doesn't have an opening on the top. I mean, whether it's hollow inside or not, I'm not sure, but it's enclosed. So and dango in itself has different meanings, isn't it?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's based on a Japanese word which means rounded form or mound, but it also has sort of a popular culture definition of a round dumpling, sort of a term of endearment. So these are, you know, large round forms or large round dumplings, and actually this triangular form that we were looking at with a crisscrossing surface. That's sort of a broad-shouldered, or what's deemed a broad-shouldered dango. Some of them are thin and elegant, some of them are squat and stout, and you can see a variety of those in this exhibition. There are at least six large-scale dangos, including this, which is in the first gallery that you encounter on the west side of the museum. And yeah, I mean, they have a real presence. They approximate the size of human scale in a way. So you approach them the way that you might approach someone else.
Right.
They have again, there's a long tradition of these sort of vertical forms in the history of art. You know, think about Stonehenge, or you know, going back to megalithic times. And you know,
Indian, what do they call them, lingas and linga. I'm thinking that. I'm just coming up with it.
Yeah.
But the column.
Right.
The column has a lot to say.
Sure. So, and you know, the surfaces. In some cases, the black one on the left, for example, has kind of a geometric on one side, and then if you walk around it, you'll see drips coming down. You know, so he varies, you know, tight geometry with loose sort of expression in some cases the same piece. So
so he's mixing different different arenas of abstract culture in there as well.
Absolutely.
So many of these can qualify as paintings.
Right. Sure. If you think about the surface as a canvas, or as a place or a medium to apply the glaze or the coating. Yeah. Here's another example of, you know, one of the dangos where the bottom portion you see the drip, the upper portion you see the kind of color field and geometry dividing the piece. So he's very creative and clever with his surfaces. That's for sure.
Yeah, his designs are exquisite, really. Yeah. Really love this stuff.
Yeah, and here's one. It's pure geometry, kind of a sawtooth edge, alternating between that hallmark blue that we saw in the head, and this kind of steely gray effect as well. And this is the largest dengo in this particular gallery in terms of height, and this one is upwards of 70 inches tall. So it's a big piece.
Good, about 6 foot. Yeah. Wow, that's a big piece. And okay, there was the.
Yeah, that's that smaller one with the geometric forms, the XO, and the clean geometry with the drips going down, and the other side of this is a different surface. He's kind of split it in two vertically, sort of bifurcated the piece. But again, the surface interest, I think, again, you're first struck by the size and the mass, and then, you know, as you sort of explore what's going on the piece, it engages you even more, and you know, this is a show where you know people walk around and you see them bending over and looking at all of the different angles, and that's always a good thing when you can engage an audience like that. You know, it's not sort of a static machine gun row of two dimensional pieces on the wall. It's much more interactive with the viewer
round. It's physical, not so much mental. You like when you're looking at paintings, and we'll see some paintings in here too.
Yeah.
But when you're dealing with sculpture, you get close to the object. Mm-hmm. It actually has a, like you were saying about human scale, about being like having a physical relationship with you, so that you can actually, you can feel it there.
Sure.
And that's I like that about art. Yeah. What is it? The poetics of space.
Yeah. Well, the other thing is that the service, Smith Kramer Traveling Exhibition Services, who is touring this show as part of a 10-city tour over 2 years, and we're proud to be part of that tour, but they didn't allow any of the dangos, the large pieces, to be put on pedestals. The idea is they need to go on the floor, and that this was part of what Kaneko's style was, that this he wanted them to be engageable objects, so that there's no separation between the viewer and the object. And part of the video shows Kaneko walking through a similar installation where he sort of just touches them all sort of gently as he goes through, like they're they're old friends, or he's greeting them. And so again, that part of the video element I think adds another dimension to the show.
This is another broad,
one of those broad shoulder pieces. Yeah, sort of an inverted triangle, and this is on the east side of the installation. You can see looking back to the head. So we took points of view into account in terms of the way the visitor engages with the show or experiences the show, pulling him either into the west or the east wing. And I think this was the large piece that we chose with the polka dots. The other thing that's kind of interesting about his surfaces is they're not just two-dimensional. Each of those polka dots that you see in this photograph have shadows attached to them. So they're kind of floating there, creating their own shadows. Again, they're not one-dimensional or two-dimensional. I think Kaneko is playing with three-dimensional decoration or ornament, whatever you want to call the glaze in these, and that's kind of interesting too. And then the background, you see a shot at some of his wall slabs, which are essentially paintings on flat slabs of clay.
I have to say too that the weight of these things, even the small slabs, when Michael had me in pre-show to take a look at everything,
sure.
I mean, he says, "Well, I'm not supposed to do this," but he goes to shift one, and so I could get a photograph of it, and it was like, "Oh my God!" He's like, "Maybe I better not do this."
yeah, they're definitely they're formidable. In terms of their weight.
Of their, yes. well, the, see, okay, here's a...
Yeah, this is a small dango, still considered a dango because it's a closed form. This one nearly circular, but you can see it sort of has the coil or the almost like the conch repeated motif. If you were to look at it from the end, you could see the spiral, which occurs in nature. And up on the wall is a drawing which also has that same motif. So that you know, there are links that can be made between his two-dimensional, three-dimensional works. This is a small dango that weighs maybe about 150 pounds, so a lightweight
small
compared,
one. Yeah.
Lightweight compared to some of the other
the
ones.
500-pound right. One, yeah. Yeah, that's a pretty, but that's very nice, though. I really like, this is one of my favorites, to be honest.
Yeah.
I like that.
Yeah, this is another one that's in that same gallery, and this one, again, maybe about 30 inches or so, weighing about 300 or 350 pounds. But these are of pedestal size that we were able to sort of give them a proper presentation in that way.
Mm-hmm. And well, in a way, too, something like that, you don't want people getting too close to it. You don't want knocking them over.
Right, and we figured it would maybe get, you know, too small, it might get lost on the floor as opposed to giving it a little bit of elevation in the gallery space.
Now here's one of the ovals.
Right, that's one of the ovals. And again, you can kind of see the same motif or the same treatment of the surface that he did with that large black dango. You know, the top portion being the geometric or the color field, and then the bottom portion with those vertical drips moving down the surface, but really animating the entire piece. Yeah, these are free, you know, sort of free hanging. Works that are akin to the slabs, the difference being these are oval versus geometric or rectangular. Mm-hmm. And again, they're just it's just clay as a painting surface in a
exactly.
way.
Exactly.
You know, they come out from the wall, and you can see the shadow that is cast by the piece. But they're
pretty thick.
Yeah, they
they're
are right, thick. Several inches, and he prefers that. That approach, you know, not super thin, but again, it's kind of pushing the boundaries.
If it's too thin, it seems like it becomes ephemeral,
right.
And it doesn't really have that that mass to it that it deserves,
right.
And especially being clay.
Yeah, and I think if it were too thin too, it would conjure up the idea of functionality. You know, it would be a platter essentially, or akin to being a platter, and that's not what Kaneko is all about.
That's not what he's about at all. Because these are definitely artworks,
right.
And they're functional as artworks.
Right.
Yeah, definitely. This is great. Okay, here's another one.
Yeah, that's a slab. Again, geometry. You can see the colors: the golden, yellow, the gray, black, and that blue that is his sort of hallmark color there. And again, you can get a sense of the depth by the shadow that's cast by the gallery lighting.
He uses a lot of like Buddhist symbols too, the circle, the X, the square. So, I mean, you can see his heritage kind of bleeding through it in his in his symbols.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's not overt about it, or he doesn't. Yeah. You know, it's not something that he dictates to the viewer. But certainly, if you're aware of those things, you can't help but notice.
Well, and not that he's ever said that he was a Buddhist or any of that sort of stuff. I'm making the observations, not necessarily, you know.
Yeah, but it's fair game to do an interpretation that way.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Well, with any artist, you put it out, into the field, you're going to have be open to that. Okay, we're going to take a short break, and we'll be right back. Thank you for watching, and please stay tuned.
You're watching NAP Connection on bctv.org. Be informed, be involved, be a member. For membership information, go to www.bctv.org/support/membership. For more information about your community and an arts calendar, go to bctv.org. NAP Connection on bctv.org is underwritten by the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts Program, Partners in the Arts, and the Wachovia Foundation. For more information on how you and your business can become a program underwriter, go to bctv.org.
Hi, welcome back. Thanks for staying with us. We're discussing the artworks of Jun Kaneko at the Reading Public Museum, and we're with Scott Schweigert. And we're going to go on to the next series of pictures, because we'll literally walk you through the whole show here, folks. But there's nothing like going into the show and seeing the real thing. Like, okay, we may be showing you pictures on a screen here right now, and that's all well and good, but before this show goes down in September, which is what, September the 8th?
The 5th, I believe, yes. It's the Sunday of Labor Day weekend.
Sunday of Labor Day weekend. Go see this show. I'm serious. This is the show of the summer, and you need to see it. But anyway, this is another one of his ovals. That's a free form. It's an abstract expressionist. He's just slashing paint around, or actually glaze. But
yeah, and this one sort of has a calligraphic appearance to it as well. It looks, you know, like a character, a text character. I think that's how I read it. That form and the energy, the movement of that form, it suggests to me some sort of calligraphic connection.
So there's possibly some sort of letter in there.
Yeah, yeah, or a symbol, or something like that. Or the gesture is there, I think, for the think about ink on paper, such a strong tradition. Mm-hmm. Again, in the East, reading into those cultural interpretations again. Having the liberty to do that, because Kaneko, everything's untitled, and he sort of opens up the door to those sort of possibilities, which is always a good thing.
He certainly does, but I think that's a good thing.
Yeah.
And my background training with abstraction is predominantly American, so when you start seeing things like calligraphy, calligraphy.
Sure.
So, but anyway, that's cool. Let's take a look at the next one.
Here's that spiral form again that we saw in the three-dimensional Django. Here it is taken into one of the ovals. Again, these are wall pieces mounted on the wall, mostly two-dimensional, but you can see what he's doing with shadow, the suggestion of color, light and dark, with the blue and the black against the gray. It's subtle, but it reads in a three-dimensional way. So it comes off the wall, but the motif, the spiraling motif, is something that occurs in nature, and I think something that Kaneko is very much in tune with. I mean, think about it. He's working materials that come from the earth. He's thinking about colors that, in some cases, occur in nature. In some cases, he bumps those up a notch with the blues, the golds, and the reds. But he's very attuned with those sorts of things, and I think the results are really successful in this
case. I agree. I like the idea of illusion that he creates in there too. It's almost to me it's Max of Escher.
But it does.
I like that illusion of space. It seems like you can just like reach inside of it.
There's real depth.
Yeah, it is. It's great. And this one's a little bit more minimal.
Yeah.
And there's the spiral again.
Right. And, and again, incorporating sort of the clean lines of that spiral, but then, blurring the in-between space or letting it, drip or bleed, sort of Clifford Still, or, think of Helen Frankenthal, or, any of those artists who were working in the 60s, 50s, following this heyday of abstract expressionism. There are strains of American abstraction that I think come into Kaneko's work as well.
I agree totally. It's also, too, that blur kind of gives it the impression of motion, too. It's almost like, if you look at it in almost like a comic book form, it's almost like you put the little lines there to show that it's moving along. But it looks like he had glazed that upright and then put it on its side to disorient us a little.
He does that with painting too. Some of the paintings that we'll see in just a moment, he worked on them horizontally, and then the orientation actually ended up being vertical. So you see the drips coming off the sides, as opposed to the tops and bottoms. So this is kind of in my opinion, the abstract expressionist masterpiece in the show. This is a Django. This is a small, in terms of height, it's lower, it's squat. It has real volume and dimension, but it is low to the ground and stout, but it is filled with drips and splashes and splatters. And again, this sort of very thick calligraphic marking in black against a gray and white background.
I love that. I keep saying I like that because I just enjoy the show so much.
You know, it's great. And in total, I mean, the show is really a nice selection of his work. Again, it's a cross-section. He works in so many different media. He works in glass as well and some metals. Those aren't represented in the show. It's but there are so many dimensions to his work that this is a really good snapshot of, you know, the way he's been working over the past at least two decades. Mm-hmm. Yeah, here's another wall slab with kind of minimal color glaze at the edges. Again, the blue, the yellow, and the reds with that geometric, within the confines of the rectangle.
Well, he framed it in color, but left the inside of it white.
Yeah, and you'll see the sort of indentations that he makes too. In this one, in the lower, below that central or below that circle, there are some marks there that look accidental or like mistakes. But having been incorporated into the piece. Sometimes he leaves his hand or his fingerprints noticeable or visible in the works, and I think that's kind of, you know, the maker leaving his impression in the piece. It doesn't necessarily have a clean surface. He's taking away and he's leaving the mark of the maker.
And come to think of it, I don't think I saw a single signature any work. That has always been kind of another thing with me is that artists signing their work. Mm-hmm. If it's a work of art and it's meant to be an individual piece of art, you know, why put your name on the front of it? I mean, it seems like it's kind of like disruptive of what you really of your intentions.
Right.
But anyway, I soapbox a lot.
Yeah. Well, and there may be artist marks on the back or impressed into the bottom. I don't know because I didn't see the bottom of those huge works. But yeah, there's no question who the artist is, that's for sure.
Absolutely. On to the next one. This one here is actually three-dimensional. Each one of those little rectangles that are positioned there on the surface they jut out for maybe a fraction of an inch.
Yeah, they come out of the surface that almost looks like they're embedded in there, sort of like rocks or jewels or something like that. And this gives a good example of the color palette that he prefers. All of them, all of those colors being represented. And again, it's not quite perfect. It's not a perfect rectangle. You can see there's a little bit of play there with the surface. It seems to fold a bit, and it's a little bit off. And that's, you know, that's also part of the Eastern philosophy, is nothing is perfect in the universe. And so, you know, putting a bend in the slab or creating rows that aren't quite symmetrical, all of those things, I think, are part of that worldview that maybe Kaneko has brought to his work.
Mm-hmm. May you have everything that you want except for one thing. Yeah, I like that.
Right.
And you notice too that some of them are missing. I mean, I also it's like it's like you said, he just leaves things out in a deliberate fashion there.
Right.
Now here's your abstract one. this is the one that's just this goes all out here.
It does, yeah. Yeah, this one is one of the more dramatic ones in terms of the gesture and the drip, and the application of the glaze. Glaze is another thing that, you know, Kaneko talks about in his work is, you know, you think you're working in a particular color, but the kiln might do something to that color. It's kind of an indirect process as opposed to painting on a canvas where you know you're mixing up your color and you're applying it to the surface and you're getting what you're getting. With a glaze, it's not always the case. When you're putting down the blue, for example, it doesn't look blue. It doesn't look like it does in the when it comes out of the kiln. Mm-hmm. So there's an element of separation in the process. And Kaneko talks about that, about his own work and the idea that there's this element that you don't always quite know what's going to come out. And so that's part of his sculptural work or his ceramic work. On the other hand, he maintains that level of direct working process with his paintings and his drawings. And that's that again, that goes back to his early training as a painter when he came to the United States in the early 1960s.
And he talks about that at length in one of the videos, right?
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
So that's important.
It's kind of good to get inside his head a little bit when.
I don't know if you can really get inside of anybody's head, but right. It's good to try.
Yeah.
Are these raised?
They're not actually. No, that's all surface glaze, with the suggestion of three dimensionality, with the suggestion of space and form.
When you look at them,
fuzzy dice.
Yeah. No, this is okay. There's another
one. Some more
one.
Gesture and drip. Yeah, similar to the other one. In that same gallery. Yeah, these are kind of the tabletop sculptures, and he calls these slabs and chunks, which are kind of a nod to the material itself, which comes in slabs and chunks from the earth. And so these are relatively small scale, 15 or 16 inches high, and as you can see, we've got them installed on raised pedestals. There's that blue that we saw with the play of that blue and gray that we saw with the head in the first image, and some of the other shapes, give a nod to geometry. And here in this piece too, I mean, you can see the working of his fingers and tools. This one has real texture and surface. It's got that angle, sort of trapezoidal shape against kind of amorphous bottom. So we get the clean lines of geometry and the organic quality of nature sort of rolled into one.
And it kind of incorporates the space of the surrounding area
into it as
part of the sculpture.
It does. This one, too, you get the sharp lines of the geometry and the sort of rough, round element as well.
I like the eccentricity of this one. I just like that it's so different. It looks like it's on some kind of a shelf, but and this one here the same.
Sure. Yeah. The surface interest there is sort of like the polka dot dango that we saw earlier too.
Mm-hmm. And you can tell like where he ripped it off from the. Right. Just leaves it there.
Sure.
See, but
sure.
That's
so the clean and the rough in the same piece, the sort of duality of what he does. Okay. And this one low to the surface and relates back to that large broad-shouldered dango with this sort of bandage of the striped covering that again kind of has that three-dimensional packaged texture. It looks like tape has been wrapped around it.
Exactly.
And he does actually, he uses he tapes off some of the glazes to get those clean lines and then peels it off before it goes in for the kiln firing, and he's able to achieve those nice clean lines.
Now we're into the paintings.
Yeah, he paints too.
Amazing! Finally, we're getting to it, right?
Right.
But this is in the central foyer, right behind the big head.
Right.
And this is quite a sizable painting too. It's one maybe about 6 by 6 by 8 feet.
It's big. Yeah. It's that's a good approximation. This one he actually does sign. You can see it there in the lower right, and you can also see the same colors that he prefers. The blues, the golds, the reds, the black and the silver, the combination of the geometry and the sort of free form calligraphic approach, layering, surface interest, drips, the whole package there, and kind of a nice composition.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, it's really nice to look at. It really is. These were in the back gallery.
Right. This is a group of three paintings in this section on paintings, and all of these are quite large. So we wanted to give them as much space as possible. Mm-hmm. And again, stepping into this gallery is kind of an experience. It's a meditative. Mm-hmm. The way we've got it lit, I think it sort of speaks to Kaneko's approach. This is again, if you look at the outside edge. On right and left of this painting, you can see the drips of the work. This one is this in that same gallery, and then this one too. Yeah, look at that. You've got a close-up.
Yeah.
Great.
Yeah, because I wanted to make sure we saw that one.
So you can see that he's working on it vertically and then letting those drips go off the edge. There's no frames on these works. They're just on their stretchers. But then the orientation in the end is the other way around. So the drips end up on the sides, so as opposed to the top and the bottom. So, you know, it gives you some insight into the way that he works as well. There's those golds, blues, reds, and you know, the black and white, the kind of theme that goes, the color palette that goes throughout all of his works.
Now, I couldn't even, when I took this picture, I couldn't back up far enough without walking into the other painting.
Yeah.
Because it was really, I couldn't even get into the frame of the camera.
Sure, sure. So. Yeah, they're big. They're really, they sort of swallow you in the way, you know, kind of a Rothko or, you know, something like that might. Stripes, colors, and then the, you know, the texture of the heavily laid on impasto of each of those brush strokes is kind of, again, creating that surface interest.
And when you like we say, when you see him on a picture, on a television screen, it really doesn't do it justice. You really have to get close to these things to really get the total impact of how nice they are.
Yeah, there's no substitute for stepping into the gallery and being surrounded by three sort of looming paintings that sort of play with your eyes and your emotions. There's no substitute for that. That's for sure.
Now, whatever would have made him choose to put that red area up there in the upper right?
You know, it sort of breaks, you know, breaks the symmetry or breaks the order there. There's something a little off about that, and that's, you know, I think that's very appealing to Kaneko. He did that with the head too. If you go around to the back of it, there's a section of it that's sort of squared off and is gray.
Yeah.
So from the front, you read it as this monolithic blue, but then when you get back, to the back side of it, you see that that's broken by this very subtle, but intentional, obviously, break in terms of color. Here's a great look at the surface of his paintings to give you a sense of the dimension and.
Well, and that not everything is so exact. I mean, there's a lot of freedom in there and a lot of freehand work. It's almost like you don't really... he doesn't rely on tape for this sort of thing. I mean, a lot of... There's some artists, and I won't name them, who use a lot of tape in the processing. And although the tape is just another tool, it shows that he's relying more on his hand and his eye to hand. Yeah, than anything else.
Yeah, it's kind of, you know, like taffy, or, you know, when you look at it, it's kind of has that glistening, shimmering effect to it, like almost like candy or taffy, and that's
very,
you know,
seductive,
it has a tactile quality to it that exactly plays on your senses, not just your eyes.
Now these are some drawings here, because we're getting close. We have about 7 minutes left.
Yeah, the drawings, again, just like the paintings, the drawings reveal his part of his process, the direct line making and mark making on the support, in this case paper. He uses oil crayon, he uses charcoal in some cases, pastel and other media. But it again goes back to sort of his general philosophy of art, and I think you could, you know, see the strains running through through these drawings as well. These are smaller in scale, maybe 24 by 30 inches at the at the largest. Again, the paintings maybe 8 feet by 6 feet in scale. And so he's, at least the drawings that are in our show are among the smaller objects and more akin to the kind of wall slabs or the ovals. That's the connection that I would make in terms of scale.
Well, I thought it was a really nice variety, really a good range of size and, you know.
Yeah, in a 39-piece show, it really has a broad representation, I think. You know, Kaneko and the studio curated the show themselves, and I think they did a fine job of, you know, showing good representation.
So the artist chose all of these artworks.
He did, yes. So that, I mean, that says something as well, because it came directly from him, and the body of work maybe from the last 20 years or so.
That's great. That's really good, because it's a, well, I mean, it shows his own favorites. Okay. So you don't have, you know, somebody else making those kind of decisions for him.
Sure.
It's nice that he does it himself and he has the freedom to do it himself.
Absolutely.
Well, let's see, we just have a few more to go here. This is another, well, considered a drawing.
Yeah, this is a drawing, again, with the black and white and blue. Geometric shapes working their way into that free-form background. And there's the colors at the edges, similar to the way he colored the edge of that wall slab. But he creates, you know, again, that sense of volume. The shimmer of the surface is something that's suggested by this piece as well. And I think that, you know, the continuity, even across media, is something that is kind of remarkable about Kaneko's work.
We can see his touch.
Yeah,
and I think
for
that's
sure.
That's really one of the most important aspects that I've noticed about his work is his touch, because he really he's really hands on, and he's his organization, his composition, the way he manages to put these disparate elements in a way together to make them work. You would wonder why he would, like with that red slash there, why would he do that? But it's perfect.
Sure.
It's just right.
Yeah. And I think the viewer will make the connection between, you know, the painting, what's going on the paintings, what's going on the small sculpture, what's happening with the large dangos. And that's something I think that, you know, is really nice about the show, too, is that you're seeing people walk through and get, oh, I see what he's doing here, or I understand. You know, he's all about surface or, you know, texture, and so that's an added element too that you don't always get in a show. You know, it's really cohesive, and I think people go away thinking about what they saw.
Well, this is another aspect too of the growing importance of ceramic as an art form. I mean, I'm seeing it more and more throughout our entire artistic community that people have been using ceramics in a very creative, non-functional way, or art-functional way.
Right.
To me, it's just it just shows a really growing concern with the use of different materials. That they want to use different. That artists want to use different materials. This just seems to be a shying away from painting lately. It seems like painting has kind of hit its entire. Has done everything that's capable of doing. And now, unless you really come up with something and you really use your head to come up with something different with painting, it's going to be a little bit difficult. However, ceramic, sculpture, and we discussed this a little earlier about how sculpture has really been the one that's pushing the boundary lately. And I think that this is indicative of that work. Now, I mean, his paintings and his drawings, they add and they supplement the work that's that he does in ceramics, I think.
Right, I agree. Yeah, I mean, if you think about recent controversies in art, some of them do involve sculpture and placement and those sorts of things. And, you know, Kaneko, I think, has found a niche for himself with these highly recognizable forms. And when you see one, and you see one in another venue or another place, you instantly recognize them, and that's part of, you know, part of the artist's identity.
I was down in the Philadelphia Museum of Art, you know, for the Renoir exhibit just a couple of weeks ago, and I went through their ceramic gallery, and I, oh, there's a Kaneko.
Yes, you know? So you knew right.
I knew it. I saw it right away.
Sure, sure. And Philadelphia did play host last year to quite a few Kaneko events, including an installation at the Kimmel Center. And Kaneko actually designed costumes and sets for a performance of Madame Butterfly, which was performed there as well, too. So his diversity as an artist is pretty impressive on a lot of levels, you know, getting into theater and set design as well.
Well, that's important. That's important. Yeah. I mean, you can't just, I mean, people just don't buy art, you know, just for decoration anymore.
Sure. He's explored the boundaries, that's for sure.
Let's see, we have like one or two.
Yeah, it's another drawing of his, you know, looks like kind of a dango in an environment or in a space with a surface decoration and ornamentation on it.
This one this one calls back to the dango with the egg-shaped dango with the stripes.
Right. And there's that spiral again that's located near that small spiral dango. So again, he's sort of working out the surfaces in drawing in the same way that he's, you know, applying the glaze to those surfaces, working with negative space and color and light and shadow in each of these.
So we have less than a minute left. Is there anything that we need to say?
No. Well, I think it's one of those exhibitions for us that is wonderful for folks who don't know who Kaneko is. Once they see the work, they have to leave being impressed by the technical ability, the scale, pushing the boundaries of what clay can do, and I think leaving an impression on them that that they'll think about for a little while. And that's always a good thing. When an exhibition can achieve those things, I see it as a success.
Okay. Well, that is it. We have really covered that one. Thank you so much for joining me tonight.
Appreciate
that was great. Scott Schweigert with the Reading Public Museum, Curator of Art there. And I'm Ron Shirer for the NAP Connections. Thank you very much for joining us, and have a wonderful night.
NAP Connection originates from the Berks Community Television Studio in Reading, PA, airing live on the fourth Tuesday of the month at 9 p.m. Check your local listings for repeat programming. For more information about the New Arts Program, call 610-683-6440 or write New Arts Program, P.O. Box 82, Kutztown, PA 19530, or visit the office and exhibition space at 173 West Main Street, Kutztown. Hours are Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday, 1 to 5 p.m., Saturday, 10 to 2 p.m., or by appointment.
This project was supported by the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency, through its regional arts funding partnership, Pennsylvania Partners in the Arts, PPA. State government funding for the arts depends upon an annual appropriation by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and support from the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency. PPA is administered in this region by Berks Arts Council.
Arts programming on BCTV is also supported by the Wachovia Foundation.